Heavenly Father, we thank you today and we bless your name. We glorify you because we know you are a mighty God. You have not changed. You are the same forevermore. You are the Jesus yesterday, today, and forever. And what you did in days gone by for people like us, you are going to do for us today in Jesus' name. Our hope and expectation is high. Our faith is centered on you. And we believe today you will magnify yourself and honor our faith. And you will bless everyone in Jesus' name. This is the day you'll break our yoke. This is the day you'll heal our sicknesses. This is the day you'll pour your blessing upon us. And we are praying it will be so in Jesus' name. Bless all your people today. Thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you very much. You can sit down. Let's look at 1 Samuel chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 12 and verse 13. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and without of a beautiful countenance, and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Arise, anoint him, for this is he. The Lord was looking for a man that will be able to deliver the people of God from the harassment of the Philistines. The Lord was looking for a man that will stand as a representative of the Lord. And eventually he found David. And then he said, arise, Samuel, and pour the anointing oil on him, because this is he. And the Lord can find you today as a man. If the Lord can find you today as a woman, and the Lord can say, this is he, the hope of your community, the hope of people around you. This is she, the one the Lord has been looking for, the one that will mop the ground, and the one that will rout the enemy, the one that will conquer the seas, the face, the people of God. This is he. What are we saying about David? Number one, he was called. Number two, he was chosen. Number three, he was anointed. Those three words and those three things that took place in the life of David: called, chosen, and anointed. How important that is. The anointing came upon him. And as the anointing came upon him, that's what I've read to you in 1 Samuel chapter 16. And then in the very next chapter, we find Goliath standing at the gate between him and the fulfillment of his calling. And I'm going to tell you today, anytime the Lord calls and chooses and anoints, there will be something standing between you and the fulfillment of that calling. That thing you'll find out, if you have not found out already, will want to challenge the call of God upon your life. Called, you are called to repentance. Called, you are called to righteousness. Called, you are called to redemption. And as the Lord calls you, and then you respond to that call of God, then you are chosen. The people who are chosen are the people who respond to the call. And then, as he calls and chooses, then he says, don't go yet. For you to be able to do everything the Lord has called you to do, right in front of you, there is something that you need. That is the anointing of the Spirit of God. We're told in verse 13 of that 1 Samuel, chapter 16, verse 13. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David. from that day forward, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. As you have seen, a man called, chosen, and anointed. And yet you understand, the anointing does not make you to be or to sleep on a bed of roses for the rest of your life. The anointing actually gets you up and makes you to be able to face what will try to challenge the call of God in your life. What will challenge the choice of God in your life? What will challenge the anointing of God upon your life? That's why you find chapter 17 following immediately after chapter 16. Understand, the anointing will always be challenged. Goliath was coming against him now. And if he overcame this Goliath, that will open the door for him to overcome all the other enemies. Goliath was standing at the gate. Overcoming Goliath in this chapter 17 of 1 Samuel will open the door for a lifetime of overcoming. On the other hand, being defeated by Goliath at this time will end his life, will end his ministry, will end every prospect, every possibility of success in the future in his life. That's why this gateway into the blessing, this gateway into the victory, this gateway into the overcomer's life was very important for David, and it's very important for you and for me. The unconquerable David. What made him to be unconquerable? I'm going to look at this message under three subtitles. Number one, the characteristics of unconquerable David. Point number two, the combatants against unconquerable David. The combatants against unconquerable David. Number three, conquering like unconquerable David. Conquering like unconquerable David. I come to number one, the characteristics of unconquerable David. What did God see in David? What did God appreciate in David? What is God looking for in your life? That he will say, I'm going to put all my power, all the divine energy, all the possibilities of faith, all the possibilities of grace into your life. What's he looking for? The Lord himself tells us in Acts of the Apostles chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 22. Acts chapter 13, verse 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David. When he had removed Saul, he raised up unto them David. Now we know that God is no respecter of persons. God is no respecter of faces. God is no respecter of titles. God is no respecter of tribes. God is no respecter of people. If he removed Saul and he put David, there must be a reason. And it's very simple. What he found in David, he didn't find in Saul. That's why he removed him. And then he brought on David. That's what God always does. God says, this is what I'm looking for. That's the quality I'm looking for. These are the characteristics I'm looking for. And it doesn't matter coming from any tribe, coming from any community, coming from any nation, coming from any group of people. This is what I'm looking for. And wherever he sees those qualities and those characteristics, he makes his choice. And it says in that verse 22, when he had removed Saul, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom he also gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. That's what he was looking for. He was looking for a man that will not fulfill, number one, the will of self. Number two, the will of Satan. Number three, the will of society. He will not be a man that society could dribble around. He will not be a man that society will tie a rope around his waist and be dragging him in any direction they pleased. But he'll be a man not under the control of self, not under the control of Satan, not under the control of society. He said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart. He said, this man that I found, I've been looking for a man like this for a long time. It's not his name. It's not his title. It's the condition of his heart. It's not his education. It's not his beauty. It's not his physique. It's a heart. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but God does not look on the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. And when he finds a man whose heart is aligned to the will of God, whose heart is aligned to the word of God, he says, I have found a man after my own heart who will fulfill all my will. Enough of the will of self. Enough of the will of Satan. Enough of the will of society. Now, from this moment on, from this time on, I want to fulfill only and always the will of God. That's the man. And that's the woman. It says, which shall fulfill all my will. You understand? Part of the will of God will not be too simple, will not be too easy. But the Lord was saying, this man is not going to be looking at how high, how great, how difficult the challenges are. He will put his heart, his mind to fulfilling all my will. He'll not be fulfilling my will only when he's happy. He'll be fulfilling my will every time, every moment, all the days of his life. He will not be fulfilling my will only when things go his own way and things are just as he expects. But when things are what he doesn't expect, and conditions and the direction of things around him, they go in a way he wasn't expecting, and yet he'll make up his mind, I am a man after God's heart, and I will fulfill all the will of God. If that's your mind today, if that's your heart today, then God can say, I found a man, I found a woman after my heart who will fulfill all my will. Look at verse 36. In verse 36, for David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God. That's it. Serving your generation, not by the will of self. This is how I like to do it. This is what I will do. There's a place I will go, and this is the thing I can do. And if they don't give me this to do, finish. I won't do any other thing. That's the will of self. He served his own generation, not by the will of society. He served in those generations by the will of God. That's what God is looking at. Come back to 1 Samuel chapter 13. In 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 14. But now thy kingdom shall not continue. Again, talking to Saul. Talking to Saul. Now thy kingdom shall not continue. Would you look up here for a moment? You see, there are many people that do not understand the word of God. And you know, in this church, we all say we don't believe in eternal security for salvation. What that means is there are people that say once you are saved, you're always forever saved. That's not Bible. That's the doctrine of Calvin. That's Calvinistic. But the Bible teaches there is only conditional security. You are saved, and then you keep on relying on the grace of God. You keep on relying on the strength of the Lord from within, so as to walk and to live in the will of God, in the word of God. Conditional security, not eternal security for salvation. Yet, in this church, there are people that appear to believe eternal security, not for salvation, but eternal security in service. Not for salvation, but for service. But the word of God is telling us there is no eternal security for salvation. There is no eternal security for service. And when God chose Saul, if there were eternal security, he would not have removed him. But he removed him because there's no eternal security in the service of the Lord. That's why if you are working for the Lord and the Lord has chosen you, he wants you to have the characteristic of abiding in the word of God, abiding in the will of God, abiding in the path of righteousness. If you sin, if you go after the will of self, or go after the will of Satan, or go after the will of society, and you abandon the will of God, the consequence is he will act to you like he acted to Saul. It says in that verse 14, but now that kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought him, a man after his own heart. And the Lord has commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee. Look at Psalm 40. And you see this man after God's heart. And you see the devotion of his heart, the decision of his heart, the dedication of his life. Psalm 40, as you look at the top of that psalm, you see it's a psalm of David. What did he say? Verse 8. In verse 8, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I delight to do thy will. I rejoice to do thy will. You can tell where his heart was. Psalm 143, verse 10. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. This man said, I know you have called me. I know you have chosen me. I know you have anointed me. And I want to be at the very center of your will. Teach me, Lord, to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. What a great revelation in our lives. If there is no test, there will be no testimony. If there is no fight, there will be no victory. If there is no opposition, there will be no conqueror. If there is no battle and no warfare, there will be no conquering. You see, there are many people, I want to be more than a conqueror, but to fear challenges. I want to be more than a conqueror, but to fear the good fight of faith. I want to be more than a conqueror. But you fear persecution and opposition. If there is no test, no trial, no trouble, there will be no testimony. If there is no conflict, if there is no opposition, if there is no persecution, if there is no challenge, if there is no difficulty, how will you be a conqueror? What made David to be a conqueror, more than a conqueror, is that he had combatants that fought against him. And what will make you a conqueror in your life, more than a conqueror in your life, more than people that have the ordinary level victory, is the conflict, the battle, the warfare, the stronghold, the challenge that come against you. Point number two, the combatants against unconquerable David. 1 Samuel chapter 17. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 4, and there went out a champion of the camp of the Philistines, named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Here we meet the champion from the enemy camp. And you ask yourself the first question. Did Goliath know David? No. Was Goliath really after David? No. Goliath was representing the Philistines. And the Philistines were after Israel. The Philistines were after the nation. And the Philistines were after Saul. They knew Saul. They didn't know David. The Philistines knew Israel. They didn't know David. And so, when David came out, Goliath was fighting against him, not because there was a personal quarrel, a personal conflict, a personal battle, a personal challenge. He was fighting him because he represented the nation. Satan is not really after you. As an individual, it's after the church, it's after Christ. But he cannot fight Christ. Christ is seated on the right hand of majesty on high. Christ is seated down on the throne of authority and power, highly exalted above principalities and powers. And therefore Satan really is against the church, the Israel of God. And you happen to be a follower of Christ, a representative of the church. And it's because you have a part in the church, it's because of your place, your position in the church, that's why Satan is after you. Ordinarily, he wouldn't bother you. Ordinarily, Goliath will not confront, will not bother David. But because of who he was standing for, he was standing for God. I found a man after my heart. He was standing for Israel. Choose you a man that will fight against me. If I overcome him, then you will be our slaves, our servant. If he can overcome us, then we will be your slave. That's the challenge today. The battle line is drawn. And the devil wants to fight against your life. But you know, if you do not understand, if you do not know who your enemy is, you'll be fighting shadows. You'll spend all your ammunition, all your strength, all your ability. You'll waste your anointing if you're fighting the wrong enemy. Now, you have seen here in verse 4 that Goliath was a champion of the Philistines. You don't have Philistines there. Neither do you have the same Goliath of that age, of that time, of that era, of that epoch, right now. Who then is a Goliath today? To answer that question, you ask yourself, what did Goliath want to do to David? He wanted to kill him. What is the sin today that wants to kill you. That's the Goliath. What did Goliath want to do to David? He wanted to give his flesh to the birds of the air. What is it today that wants to give your life to the birds of the air? I mean to the demons and the evil spirits. That's the challenge. That's what we're going to find out. What did Goliath want to do? He wanted to defeat David so as to show Israel that Israel cannot stand, that the nation cannot stand. What is it today that wants to defeat your life to show to the world that the church does not have the power, the purity that the church is claiming to have? That's what you'll find out. That is the Goliath today that we're fighting against, and we're going to win. We're going to overcome in Jesus' name. In fact, it says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. With him is the arm of flesh, and with us is our God, and he will give us the victory. Now, as we find out the Goliath of today, I'm going to spell that word Goliath for you. Why don't you spell it for me? Won't you go? How many letters? 7. G for greed. You see, if there is anything that wants to destroy us today, it's greed. Many people don't understand. They go last today. You know, we stand up. And then we're fighting against this, against that. Before you pray and before you fight, what is it today that wants to destroy our Christian life? What is it today that wants to make us fall? What is it today that wants to destroy us spiritually, physically, and in every way? And what is it today that wants to destroy our service for the Lord? Greed. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 and verse 10. For they that will be rich, those who are greedy, greedy of gain, for they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and awful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith. They have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. If greed destroys you, if the love of money gets the better part of your life, if greed, running after money, makes you to deviate from the will of God and from the word of God, Goliath has conquered you already. Now, oh, that is oppression. You see, oppression. And you find it everywhere. And that oppression is the Goliath of today. It's like that in every office. It's like that in every community. Oppression. Oppression. What does oppression do? Oppression destroys us if we do not know how to conquer Goliath. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 7. Surely, oppression maketh a wise man mad. Surely, oppression maketh a wise man mad. If you're looking for a literal Goliath today, you won't find. If you say, I am ready, I'm going to fight Goliath, you will not find the Goliath we found in 1 Samuel chapter 17. But the oppression you'll find in every locality. In the house where you are living as a tenant, the oppression is there. In the office where you are working, the oppression is there. In the place where you are schooling, the oppression is there. And they will try to conquer you with oppression. You wait there and they're asking for promotion, and you don't submit to this, they'll oppress you. And if you don't know how to conquer Goliath, that oppression will conquer you. And even, you know, among the people that call themselves Christians, they will try to oppress you so as to be able to crush your spirit. and to destroy your soul, and then to be able to nullify your consecration. Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad. Eventually, when the oppression comes to his height, you'll be acting as a mad man or a mad woman, and then they'll be laughing at you. They are the people that caused that sort of temporary madness, but they'll be laughing at you because they know it is their oppression that is turning you to another thing. And then they'll be saying, but you said you can pray, but you said you can stand, but you said you are consecrated. Oppression, that's the goal today, but we shall conquer in Jesus' name. What's the next letter? That's Lucifer. L, Lucifer. You know, sometimes Lucifer himself will come. He'll say, my messengers are not doing it right. My messengers are not dealing with you hard and tough enough. And therefore, Lucifer will come. That's the Goliath of today. The Goliath of 1 Samuel chapter 17 is gone. It's dead. But another Goliath is rising up today. Is a champion of the principalities of the power of the air. He will try to challenge your life in Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. In Isaiah chapter 14, reading from verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? Lucifer will fall in your life. Satan will fall in your life. Wherever Satan comes against your life, wherever that Lucifer comes against your life, you will overcome. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. Ye of God, little children, and have overcome them, we will overcome them. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And then I come to I, that's infirmity. Infirmity. Luke 13, verse 11. It tells us, and behold, there was a certain woman which had a spirit of infirmity. There was a certain woman which had a spirit of infirmity. You know, that's the Goliath of today. The Goliath of today. Infirmity. And sometimes, you know, people don't even worry sometimes because of this kind of infirmity. Would you look up here? There are two kinds of sicknesses. There is what we call horizontal sickness. Horizontal is a line that you draw that is going from left to right, that is going from west to east, that is lying down. There is a vertical sickness, and the vertical sicknesses are more in number than the horizontal sicknesses. Let me explain to you. There are some few sicknesses that will make you lie down. You are bedridden. That's horizontal sickness. And you cannot eat for yourself, by yourself. And you cannot do anything by yourself. That's the horizontal sickness. But you see the other sicknesses, which are very, very serious. That's the vertical sickness. You might still be standing. You might still be walking about, but you are sick. Infirmity. You see this woman, she had a spirit of infirmity. What kind of sickness is that? Vertical sickness. It was serious, but she could still come out. Jesus didn't go to her house. She was still able to come out of the house, but for 80 years, vertical sickness. Do you remember that woman with the issue of blood, 12 years, vertical sickness? And you know, she was still able to move about. That's how she came to the crowd. Vertical sickness. Do you remember Bartimaeus? Bartimaeus had vertical sickness. He was blind, but he could come out of the house and go to the side of the road and be begging. And when he heard that Jesus was passing by, he got up and he followed after, have mercy on me. Thou son of David, I want to receive my sight. Vertical sickness. You know the people that have ulcer? Vertical sickness. Even the first stage of cancer, you might still be walking about. I'm feeling the pain here. I'm feeling the pain there. Vertical sickness. You're still walking about. You're still functional in a way. Go to school. Go to the market. go to the office. But that sin is very serious. And some people don't care about the vertical sicknesses until the sicknesses become so serious and they're lying down and it becomes an horizontal sickness. But vertical or horizontal will get rid of them.
Yeah.
A spirit of infirmity, that's now in verse 11, 18 years and was bowed together. And she could no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And I tell you, you are released from your infirmity. And in verse 13, and he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. G for Greek, O for oppression, L for Lucifer, I for infirmity, A for abominations. Abominations. You're asking yourself, what is destroying many people today? What's destroying their future? Abominations. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, Deuteronomy chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 9. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. After the abominations of those nations, there shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord thy God does drive them out from before thee. You see, what makes the Lord to drive us away from his presence? Drive us away from the victory. Drive us away from conquering. Drive us away from the inheritance that he wants to give us. It's because of abomination, the witchcraft, the familiar spirit, the occultism, and the cult, the joining of the cults. You know, sometimes there are parents that will say, and they take it lightly. They say, well, my son, my daughter joined the cults. Well, you know, then they'll say, these young people, they are experimenting almost everything on earth. And my daughter now, or my son now, has joined the cults. That's Goliath. And the cult coming into your family, witchcraft coming into your family, and secret cults coming into your family, occultism coming into your family, will destroy that family. It's not just that child, because that child joining occultism has brought the presence of Satan into your family. That's Lucifer finding a seat, finding a throne right there in your family. And if you don't do something about it, that's the Goliath that wants to destroy you. For this day, they'll be destroyed in Jesus' name. See? Temptations. Temptations. Those are the things wanting to destroy us. Like Goliath, wanting to destroy the people of God. James chapter 1. In James chapter 1, from verse 12, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. Blessed is the man that stands against temptation, the temptation of the flesh, the temptation of covetousness, stealing, the temptation of marrying an unbeliever, the temptation of going along with the world in their politics, the temptation of doing evil, the temptation of becoming wicked, the temptation of abandoning the will of God in your life. Blessed is the man that stands against, that endures, that resists temptation. For when he's tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. Let no man say, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. You see that? And that's the Goliath wanting to destroy us, bringing forth death. Each hatred of hostility. Hatred of hostility. What do we call hostility? Hostility is long abiding anger in the heart. You know, somebody has done something against you, and you cannot pass it by and go your way. Somebody has done something that embarrassed you, made you unhappy. It's all right to be unhappy. It's all right to be temporarily sad. Being unhappy is different from being angry. Being sad is different from being angry. You are a human being. Although you are born again, you are saved. If somebody slaps you, you'll feel the pain. You'll feel unhappy. You'll feel sad. But if you allow the unhappiness or the sadness to degenerate into anger, and then you become angry in a settled manner, that anger is brewing and brewing and growing in your heart until it becomes hostility. That actually is the Goliath. It's not just the Goliath of 1 Samuel chapter 17 trying to destroy you. That anger, hostility, hatred comes against your life to destroy you. In 1 John chapter 3 verse 15. 1 John chapter 3 verse 15. Whoso hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. If you have hatred in your heart, then you have lost eternal life. And you see hatred or hostility will show in different ways. You know, there are people that get angry and they have hatred and they break plates in the house. There's something that's happened between the parents and the children, between the husband and the wife, and then you have this hatred and this anger, animosity in that, and start breaking plates. That's one manifestation of anger. Other people don't do like that when they are angry. Other people have deep-seated anger and they are quiet. You know, there are some people that are just totally, absolutely quiet when they are angry. And some people, they withdraw when they are angry. They withdraw their smile. They withdraw their beautiful face. They withdraw the goodness they used to do or they used to have. The anger, the hostility, the hatred makes them to withdraw, withdraw, withdraw. We call it fight or flight. Some people have hatred, they fight. Other people have hatred, they flee, they run away, they withdraw. But you see, if the hatred is in the heart, that hatred is a sin that comes to destroy you. But you will not be destroyed. You will conquer Goliath. And as you recognize now the description of Goliath in our lives, the greed, the oppression, the Lucifer, the infirmity, the abomination, the temptation, and the hatred. Now you come with faith. How did David conquer? How did David overcome? In 1 Samuel chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 32. Conquering like unconquerable David. Conquering like unconquerable David. Verse 32. It says, and David said to Saul, Let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Number one, that's the courage of faith. The courage of faith. Thy servant will go and fight against this Philistine. Number two, the conviction of faith. Verse 33. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock, and I went out after him, and smote him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by the beard, and smote him, and slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. That is the conviction of faith. He said, I cannot be defeated. I cannot be conquered. But I'm going to conquer, I'm going to defeat that Philistine. Number three is the confidence of faith. The confidence of faith. You see, when you believe the word of God, and you know you are called, and you know you are chosen, and you know you are anointed, and that anointing abides on your life, then you have the confidence of faith. Verse 37. David said, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go, and the Lord be with thee. Number four, the contradiction of faith. As you are believing the Lord and you say, yes, I'm standing on this word of the Lord, there may be people that will suggest some other method apart from the name of God, apart from the name of Jesus, apart from the blood of Jesus, apart from the power that resides in your faith in the word of God. The contradiction of faith. Verse 38. And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put an helmet of brass upon his head. Also he armed him with a coat of mail, and David girded his sword upon his armor. And he has said, he tried to go, for he had not proved it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not proved them. And David put them off him. And he took his staff in his hand, and he chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook, and put them in a shepherd's bag, which he had, even in a scrip. And his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. He drew near to the Philistine. You see, there will be the contradiction of faith. They'll give you methods. They'll give you ideas. They'll call you to go places as if going to those places will solve the problem of your life. But you need to understand that the name of Jesus is what you have. And at the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And then we're told that when he took those 5 stones and the slings, he drew near to the Philistine. He drew near to Goliath. Don't run away. Draw near. You see, when you draw nearer, you see that your problem is smaller. If you draw away, if you draw back, if you run away, the farther you go, the bigger the problem will seem to you. You're seeing that those witches are mighty and powerful when you're running from them. You'll be trying to dream up ideas about them when you run away from your difficulties. When you run away from your challenges, when you run away from your Goliath, it appears greater and bigger in your sight. But when you run towards them and you go in the name of the Lord, you'll find Goliath will become actually smaller and a target for your sling and for your stone. And then I come to number 5, the contempt of the flesh. the contempt of the flesh. Verse 41. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David. And a man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him. He belittled him. He ridiculed him. He insulted him. He abused him. Don't worry for their abuse or their insult or their assault or their disdain or their belittling you or their humiliating you. That's their trade. That's their work. But you know, you come in the name of the Lord. For he was but a youth and ruddy, and of a fair countenance. And the Philistines said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said unto David, come unto me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. That's the contempt of the flesh. I come to number 6, the confession of faith. The confession of faith. Today you will confess your faith. And then you will possess what you confess. Verse 45. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day, when will your victory come? This day, when will you conquer? This day, when you have the victory? This day, when will you bring Goliath in your life down? This day, the confession of faith. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee and take the head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistine this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Then number 7, the conquest of faith. The conquest of faith. And it came to pass in verse 48, when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead. You will smite the Philistine. You will conquer the Philistine. You will conquer every Goliath in your life. And then we're told, and the stone sank into his forehead, and he fell upon his face. So David prevailed over the Philistine. So David prevailed over the Philistine. He prevailed. I will prevail. I will prevail. I will prevail. Let me show you the consequence of that prevailing. Look at verse 52. And the men of Israel and of Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines, until thou come to the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell by the way to Shaharim, even unto Gath and to Ekron. You see, when David overcame, I told you that David was standing as a representative of the children of Israel. When David overcame, he overcame Goliath. All the other children of Israel, they also ran after the Philistines, and they pursued them and they prevailed on them. Because Jesus Christ, the son of David, because he has prevailed over Satan, the prince and the champion of the enemies, because we are his followers, we're going to arise, and we're going to pursue, and we're going to conquer. Every problem is taken away. Every challenge, the Lord is giving us the victory. And every disease, every sickness, every infirmity, every work of the devil will be destroyed in Jesus' name. Rise up and conquer your Goliath. Rise up and conquer your problem. Rise up and conquer. In the battle that is raging now, you're going to overcome. This day, the Lord will grant you the victory. Why don't you present that problem before the Lord and say, Lord, here is a Goliath. The greed, the oppression, the Lucifer, the devil, Satan, the infirmity, the sickness, that spirit of infirmity that has been upon your life all these years. Might be horizontal sickness or vertical sickness. Oh Lord, I am more than a conqueror today. Abominations, that's a Goliath. Abominations, that's a Goliath. You'll be the man today, be the woman today, the woman of God's choice, a man after God's heart, a woman after God's heart, not self-willed, not Satan-controlled, not society-controlled. I found a man, I found a woman after my heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Be an overcomer today. Be a victor today. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And come to the Lord with faith for the courage of faith. Come to the Lord with faith for the conviction of faith. Come to the Lord with faith for the confidence of faith. And you reject the contradiction of faith. Don't mind their contempt of the flesh. Move on with the confession of your faith. Because what you confess is what you will possess. What you confess is what you will possess. And that is what will lead you to the conquest of faith. This is the day, the day of victory. This is the day of conquering. This is the day of conquest. And today, you can be more than a conqueror through the power of the one that has called you and chosen you. Called, chosen, and anointed for the battle day. Called, chosen, and anointed for the day of battle. In Jesus' name we pray. If you believe you have the victory, say good amen. You believe that the shout of the people of God will bring every Jericho wall down, another amen. This is the day of your victory. This is the day of your conquest. And this is the day of your success. Why don't you raise up your hand for your victory? Raise up your hand for your conquest. And raise up your hand for your success. You have got it already. I said you have got it already. Enough of the time of testing. Now the time of testimony has begun. All the powers of darkness, they are brought down and they are destroyed in your life in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because as we come to your presence today, Every Goliath will bow before us. Every Goliath will be defeated before us. Every Goliath is conquered before us. We come in the name of the Lord and we destroy every work of the devil in Jesus' name. The Goliath of besetting sin. The Goliath of self-will. The Goliath of Satan's control. You are destroyed in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray you bring spiritual victory to every one of us in Jesus' name. And then the Goliath of infirmity. The Goliath of sickness. The Goliath of horizontal sickness or vertical sickness. I come against you right now. Come out in Jesus' name. And for all those who are sick, I pronounce healing upon your life. For those who are attacked, afflicted, and oppressed, I pronounce deliverance upon your life. And for those who are weak and you are being defeated, I pronounce dominion and victory over your life in Jesus' name. Goliath is destroyed. Goliath is defeated. You are conquered already. You are more than a conqueror. And you are healed, you are delivered, and you are successful in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, I pray right now, there will be a shout of praise, a shout of hallelujah in the midst of the people of God, and your victory will be confirmed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Give me an amen of the conqueror. An amen of unconquerable believer. Thank you very much, and God bless every one of you.